information you want when you need it. This is your Talk of the Town News Update.
Good morning. I'm Trent McGee. Some members of the Republican Party in North Carolina are now calling for Senator Richard Burr to be censured after he became one of only seven GOP senators who voted to convict former President Donald Trump during his impeachment trial Saturday. The vote was 57-43 to acquit Trump on charges of inciting an insurrection on the U.S. Capitol. An official statement is expected to be released later today following a meeting of the state Republican Party leaders. COVID-19 key metrics continued to show signs of improvement on Sunday. Data released by the Department of Health and Human Services showed that hospitalizations in the state dropped to their lowest level in 3 months to 1,989. There were also 3,170 new cases of the coronavirus reported Sunday, a decrease of 960 from the day before. North Carolina's test positive rate remained at 6.5%. The state's largest school district returns for in-person classes today. The thousands of Wake County school students will return for in-person classroom instruction. Under the latest model, pre-K through third grade students, along with K-12 special education students in regional programs, will attend daily in-person classes. Students in grades 4 through 12 will return on a three-week rotation of in-person and online classes. Based on federal guidelines, the last week for which North Carolina can pay extended benefits to claimants is the week ending February 20th, 2021, the end of this week. Extended Benefits is a federal program that extends state unemployment insurance benefits during periods of high unemployment in a state. Nearly $10 billion has been paid out in unemployment benefits across North Carolina since March of last year. And President Biden is pushing for a range of reforms to the nation's gun laws on the third anniversary of the deadly school shooting at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida. Biden released a statement Sunday calling for background checks on every gun sale. He also wants a ban on assault-style weapons and an end to immunity for gun manufacturers. I'm Trent McGee with your Talk of the Town news headlines.
Okay, so... We are really struggling. North Carolina Network really has screwed us up this morning. They were supposed to fire at 8 o'clock, and they didn't fire. And Michael has been doing his best, and we're miscommunicating. We've had a lot of dead air. Let's do the weather. It's going to be mostly cloudy with high temperatures today. Back into 50s. Thank goodness. Going to get up to 50 or so today. And then 40s, is it? Is that right? It gets the overnight low is 59. It's going to get warmer as the day goes on. That's crazy.
Be in the mid-60s tomorrow.
I mean, 65 tomorrow, but windy with showers. Of course, 65, but showers. Only a 40% chance. That's a good thing. And then on Wednesday, no rain and sunshine, temperatures up around 50 degrees. It's just going to be another kind of cold week off and on, but temperatures in the 60s a couple of days this week, so there you go. Current temperature outside, 41 degrees. All right, welcome to the program. We have got we've got to kind of get our act together here. This is not exactly what we had planned to do, but Michael, I will improvise just like you have this morning. We've had to try to do that. Plus, we've had my buddy Sam Holding down in Beaufort forever. We've been talking about Richard Burr and whether or not he should resign this morning after his vote. A lot of upset people in the Republican Party will take a vote in their central committee tonight to censure Senator Burr if they can get the votes, and I'm pretty sure they can. Let's go to Beaufort and my buddy Sam, who's been holding a long time. Good morning, Sam.
Hey, good morning.
How you doing?
I think I'm doing fine, other than this rain is
it's killing us all.
It's like a hurricane without the wind.
And I will say, for folks who don't know my friend Sam down in Beaufort, Sam has worked in politics for many, many, many years and worked in Washington, D.C., and worked for some big – did you ever work for Burr?
Well, I have to admit that I did for a little while on one of his campaigns and then for about 6 months on his staff when I decided to go work for Senator Helms for a little while before I moved to the beach. But, you know, he needs to resign, and it just exposes the fracture of the establishment Broyhill wing of the party versus the Helms Trump-type people. And I think it was just a poke in the eye at at the conservative base. You know, you mentioned in your comments earlier that he kind of was a ghost in Eastern North Carolina. Well, he got what he wanted from Eastern North Carolina with their votes. But as far as being a respectful guy to the conservative base, there was a congressman who's now deceased who nicknamed him Sir Richard because he thought he was royalty up there.
I forgot about that. I know who you're talking about.
And that kind of just points to how he thinks he's smarter than everybody up there. And I guess he figured that with this vote, it was going to further his chances on getting some of those high-paying corporate boards, maybe for Facebook or Google or Twitter.
Well, the other rumor has been that he's going to try to do some lobbying when he gets out. But, I mean, who's he going to lobby? I don't think the Democrats want to see him, and the Republicans now, they're not going to want – you know, I wouldn't hire him to lobby Republicans if I was a company or somebody that needed a lobbyist, so – I don't know.
Well,
I'm just disappointed in it. I tried to be benign in my comments about what was going on during the investigation of the insider trading. I never thought it was insider trading, but I thought it was just kind of an ethics question, and was kind of disappointed in him with that. But I never felt like he did anything that he should be convicted for on that. And I said that on the air. So I've been supportive of him, but you know I don't see him much anymore unless we're trying to unless he's down here trying to raise money. And so, I mean, yeah. I'm just ready for him to resign now. I just think there's the main reason, Sam, why I think Senator Burr should resign, because of what I said earlier. We've got to get the party to come together, and this fractures us further, don't you think?
I totally agree with those statements, Henry. It totally fractures it. You know, it's when the establishment wants the conservative base to lockstep get in line behind them, like we did with Tillich. You know, I'm a conservative, but you know, I wrote a letter to the editor to the News and Observer and publicly stated you got to vote for Tillich, whether you agree with him or disagree with him. We've got to stick together to win because, you know, these are votes for the Supreme Court and various other important things moving forward. But unfortunately, people like Richard Burr, it's a one-way street with them. They want us to go give them the money, do the work, and vote for them. But when it comes to supporting somebody on the other side, in this case, the Constitution and a guy who happened to get caught in the crossfire, President Trump, oh no, I'm going to just poke him in the eye because it's all about political power.
Yep.
With these guys. They don't care about.
We'll see what that. Do you have if he did resign, do you have a favorite on who should be put in there to be the incumbent to run next year? I've already said I'm a McCrory guy at this moment. I know that Lindsey Graham kind of re-announced Laura Trump was going to get in a race yesterday. I don't know if it's true or not, but of course.
I don't necessarily have a favorite. I do know I spoke with some people in Winston-Salem yesterday, and they don't even think Mark Walker is a viable candidate, especially after this insurance whatever happened there.
Yeah, he's got I like Reverend Walker, but he's got to do some damage control on that. I mean, if he were the nominee, that would come out big time. I don't think he did anything illegal, but you know, when all those you ended up having people get convicted of felonies in that thing. This is the Robin Hayes case. And he was clearly involved in making some introductions on that and has never denied it. Yeah.
Well, I agree with you. We've got on both sides, once the dust settles in any primary, we always have to support our candidate, unless, of course, they go rob a bank and, you know, go shoot a bunch of people. But
yeah,
the Democrats get it done in that game.
Yeah. All right, Sam. Thank you for the call, man. It's great to hear from you. The great Sam Sellers down in Beaufort. Nice to hear your voice, my friend. Good morning to you.
Yes, sir.
Bye. Thanks for calling. We'll talk later. All right, let's get a quick break in. We got Becky Gray this hour. More phone calls if you want to get in. Do you agree with Sam and me that Richard Burr should resign? 252-561-8255, 866-963-1037. And who do you want to run for that seat? Who do you want to see follow Richard Burr in that seat? Try to get the Republicans to hold on to it. Give us a call. We got time for a few more phone calls before we interview Becky at the bottom of the hour. 561-8255 or 866-963-1037. Be right back.
Get ready to get more at Greenville Toyota. Get more savings on over 125 Toyotas. More savings on Corollas, $15,990. More savings on Camrys, $189. At Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
Air Service is back at Pitt Greenville Airport, offering safe, clean facilities and flights from American Airlines. That means the short commute, quicker lines, and better prices that get you where you're going fast and easy. See it for yourself. There's great things inside at Pitt Greenville Airport.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
I'm crying 'cause I love you.
Pepsi Wild Cherry.
Acre Station Meat Farm, along with Lane Angus Beef, bring you Farm to Fork Beef.
Stock your freezers now with affordable beef boxes just in time for the grilling season.
Farm to Fork Beef brings quality local beef to your family. From your traditional butcher shop, Acre Station Meat Farm. Come on down to Acre Station Meat Farm and find out why we're number one in fresh cuts and friendly service.
Acre Station Meat Farm, Highway 32 North, Pinetown.
Air Service is back at Pitt Greenville Airport, offering safe, clean facilities and flights from American Airlines. That means the short commute, quicker lines, and better prices that get you where you're going fast and easy. See it for yourself. There's great things inside at Pitt Greenville Airport.
Why settle for less when you can get more at Greenville Toyota? Get more for your trade. Right now, we're giving you 125% over book value. Plus, you always get more with our Greenville Advantage. Get more at Greenville Toyota today.
Cherry.
Kids may not be listening, but every voice-activated smart device is. Just tell it to play WTIB on TuneIn Radio. Now, back to Henry Hinton and Talk of the Town on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Talk of the Town this morning, and again, we're talking about whether or not Richard Burr is... His vote divided the Republican Party more when he voted to convict Donald Trump on Saturday. Whether or not he should resign, the chairman of the North Carolina Republican Party, Michael Whatley, called his vote shocking and disappointing. And my friend Nancy Cochran just reminded me that that the chairman of the party, Michael Whatley, will be in Greenville speaking to the Republican women of Pitt County The guest speakers for that event on Thursday at 11:30 at the Greenville Country Club are P.J. Conley, the mayor of Greenville, and Michael Whatley, the chairman of the North Carolina GOP. So I'll try to get Michael on this week before he does his appearance here in Greenville to talk about that and promote his appearance here in Greenville as well. But he's going to be here in town after tonight's vote. And it looks like the Republican Party will vote to censure Richard Burr tonight. Let's go back to the phone lines at 561-8255, 252-561-TALK. Or you can call our 800 line, 866-963-1037. Let's go to Mike down in Jacksonville. Good morning, Mike.
Good morning.
Yes, sir.
You love your show. I love him every morning.
Thank you, sir.
Got to go. He's got to go, and here's why he has to go. I think a lot of these guys get in power, and they forget that they were elected to represent people. And if you're elected as a conservative representing Republican conservative people, then that's what your representation should be. And he clearly didn't do that with his let's shock the world vote. So, yeah, he's got to go. He doesn't represent us, and he has no place trying to. Just my thoughts.
Have you got a replacement for him? Who would you like to see follow him if he does resign, which, you know, I'm not sure that he will even after tonight's vote. But who do you want to see?
That's a great question.
Well, the three names out there right now are Pat McCrory, Laura Trump, and Mark Walker. Do you like any of those?
I think Pat McCrory's got what it takes. Whether or not he would do what it takes, I don't know. But that's probably who I would lean toward.
Yeah. Going to have to raise a lot of money. Going to have to raise a lot of money. This is going to be a very expensive race, and it probably got more expensive yesterday with all the activities. Of course, Cherie Beasley, the former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, not declared yet, but, you know, making all sorts of noise that she's going to run. And this guy, Jeff Jackson, the good-looking young man from down in Charlotte's going to run for the Democrats. Erica Smith, don't think she's got much of a shot. Didn't think she did before this weekend, but now she's going to be embroiled in some legal issues. And right now the only declared candidate for the Republicans is Mark Walker, but Laura Trump and Pat McCrory both rattling like they're going to do it. So we'll see what happens.
It's going to be interesting either way.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate that. 561-8255. 866-963-1037. Doug, good morning. Where are you calling from, Doug? I didn't get that.
I'm calling from Stella Tier. I'm in between Stella and Pelletier.
Stella Tier.
That's right. Right here on this side, western side, beautiful Croatan Forest.
I love it. All right. Good morning. What are your thoughts about all this?
Well, as far as Richard Burr's concerned, I think he's going to have to live with himself. He's in bed with Nancy. And everybody out there is Republican. Let's do what the Democrats can't do. And that's let's forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And as far as the GOP is concerned, and this is all I got to say, is Nancy, it wasn't our house that fell on your sister. So God bless America, and God bless this show, and God bless everybody here in Carteret County, because we love it, and it's the greatest place to live. And this North Carolina was a Republican state. And let's don't forget that, folks.
Yeah.
Because we love all Americans. And Henry, thanks for what you're doing. And we love eating at Baker's, me and my mama. And that's all I got to say, brother.
All right. Well, I appreciate that phone call. I loved everything Doug said, except when he talked about somebody being in bed with Nancy, I threw up into my mouth a little bit. that was a little much. All right. Last call for a while. Gordon in Greenville, you're going to get the last word on this. We got to get to our state politics update with Becky Gray. Good morning, Gordon.
Good morning. I'd like to see Arlen Tucker from Raleigh run. I've been in several meetings with him. He's a very good conservative, and I think he'd be a great representative. Thank you.
You know, Garland, I don't really know Garland. I talked to him on the phone when he was about to run. He was going to run against Tillis, I believe, wasn't he? And he and I have a lot of mutual friends up there. I don't really know Garland, but he might be the most boring person I've ever talked to. He just doesn't have the gravitas. He's got money. And he's been involved with John Locke. And what you got him there, McGee?
He's the retired chairman of the and CEO of the Triangle Capital Corporation.
I mean, I really liked the man, and I had a lot of great conversations with him. He called me a couple of times, tried to get me on board and get me off the Tellus campaign. And, you know, I agreed with a lot of what he had to say, but I just, you know, it takes more than just political will to win a campaign. You've got to be a good candidate, and I didn't see Garland Tucker as a good candidate. I just didn't. And I don't think, you know, again, that's one of the things I love about McCrory. I mean, you know, McCrory's politics and mine pretty much line up. I mean, some people might think that he's establishment and things like that, but Pat knows what it takes to win, and he is a great candidate because he'll get out and he will work his butt off. And let me tell you something. He treats everyone the same. Because of his background, I've watched him campaign. I mean, if you're the CEO of a Research Triangle Park company, you're going to get treated the very same as the barbershop barber. You know it? Because Pat genuinely loves people. He loves North Carolina, and he loves campaigning. I mean, he loved being governor. You could say there were some missteps toward the end of his campaign. The only thing I would say about Pat is if he's going to run, he's got to pull the trigger early enough to be able to raise the money. That's why I think if he were to be put in there, if Richard Burr would resign and McCrory would go in as the incumbent, think about the ability to raise money then. It would be strong. And he'd be hard to beat as an incumbent senator. So that's why I like that idea. And right now what we've got is a lame duck guy who has divided the party and is going to do us no good in the reelection in the next guy getting elected. That's the main reason Richard Burr should resign right there, because he's going to do us no good moving forward in that position. And if he were to step down and allow someone like McCrory to go in there, it would help us retain the seat in 2022. And that's why I think he ought to step down. 8:28, let's get a break in. We're coming back. We'll talk state politics. Don't forget the legislature is. We hadn't talked about anything going on at the state level this morning. So we'll get Becky Gray in next to kind of give us an update on what's happening this week in the legislature. Stay with us.
For Fabric and Home Furnishings in Arlington Village in Greenville, my friend Lisa Pendry is here. She always says this is more than a fabric store, and I'm getting to see it for myself today, Lisa.
Yes, we're glad you're here, Henry. We do offer a lot more than just fabric. Sofas, chairs, ottomans, complete home design, and we even sell our floor samples off the floor.
Just talking to some friends that are trying to buy furniture, they're saying that it takes maybe 5 or 6 months to get furniture now. Are you guys seeing that?
We hear that a lot, but we work with craftsmen right here in North Carolina, so we're able to deliver in 6 to 8 weeks, so we're excited.
Wow, that's great. And we're sitting on this great Krypton fabric that you always talk about that
yes.
you can pour wine on. You going to demonstrate it for us?
I am. It's pretty amazing. Your family can enjoy the furniture. Your kids can do whatever. And it's just going to sit there.
Wow.
And you can wipe it right off.
And it's beautiful
fabulous.
On top of that.
Uh-huh.
Fabric and Home Furnishings, more than a fabric store here in Arlington Village. Lisa, thanks for the visit.
Thank you.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and work week daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
Living easy is the sound of children laughing as you make memories with neighbors and friends. It's the sound of nothing at all. It's the smell of the salt air. Hear the waters against the marsh grass. See the beauty of our coast, Bow Coast, located in Beaufort, North Carolina. Southern Living's best small town.
My name
name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit VidantHealth.com/COVID-19.
Up with the information you need to start your day with Henry Hinton and Talk of the Town.
All you have to do is tell me.
Hey Alexa, play WTIB on TuneIn Radio.
Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
It's something, right?
Time for our Raleigh legislative update with Becky Gray, brought to you by Nutrien this morning. The Nutrien Aurora site in Beaufort County sources phosphate ore used in fertilizer for the ag market and in food grade and industrial products, from soft drinks, potato chips, toothpaste, to IV fluids and fire extinguishers. Phosphate is a product we rely on every day. Nutrien is working to grow the world from the ground up through food production, community investment programs, and protecting the environment for generations to come. Becky Gray is on the phone. Becky, of course, from the John Locke Foundation, NC Civitas, Carolina Journal. She wears many hats. And we're going to do a legislative update, see what's coming up in the legislature this week that we need to know about and what happened last week. But Becky, I got to ask you before we get into that, the North Carolina Republican Party Central Committee is going to vote tonight to censure or not censure Senator Richard Burr. I this morning have called on Richard Burr to resign. I'm wondering what your thoughts are about this and if you think the Central Committee is really going to go through with a censure tonight. What do you think?
Well, it certainly appears so. I mean, Carolina Journal broke that story, and there were several members of the Central Committee who shared with Carolina Journal that they intended to bring this forward, that they had support for it. If you just go on social media since the vote was taken, it seems to be overwhelmingly against or in criticism of Richard Burr's vote. It came as a surprise, too. I mean, we heard that on the national news as the vote count was being taken, and the seven Republicans who voted guilty for President Trump, Richard Burr's vote was a bit of a surprise for folks. So I think, I think that even is what has affected the Central Committee and many of the members of the state party, is it came as a surprise. And I think they felt blindsided, and I think they felt they're just very disappointed. And there was a statement that came out pretty quickly after the vote that said, Michael Whatley, the chairman of the GOP, said he was very disappointed in Richard Burr's vote. So I would, for them to hold this vote, I think there's a clear indication if they're going to hold the vote, they're going to vote to censor him.
You think he'll resign?
No, I do not.
Yeah. I think that all of us in the Republican Party have to make the case to Senator Burr that he is now a divisive member of the party at a time when we're trying to bring the party back together. And, the most important thing right now is to win that seat back. He's going to hurt the Republicans' chance of winning it back. If he were to step down now, we were to put someone else in there. I've said McCrory, but it doesn't have to be McCrory. I know that Lindsey Graham said yesterday he thinks that Laura Trump now has the upper hand in the nomination. Mark Walker, the congressman from Greensboro, wants it. There are probably going to be others. But whoever, if you put a Republican, you put someone new in there now, the focus will be on getting that person reelected rather than the focus being on Richard Burr being a turncoat going into this election. That doesn't help the Republicans.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you because, right now it is Richard Burr's seat. And, you know, if he were to be replaced, then it would become that in that Republican incumbent seat. And it just puts a different twist on the election. Also, as far as fundraising and, you know, everything else. So there's a lot at stake. I mean, the fact that we're already talking about all of this, and not just you and me, Henry, but I mean, go on the national news, and there's a lot of talk about this across the country. I think it illustrates, again, how important North Carolina is and what a battleground state, and where the Tillis Senate seat in the 2020 election was pivotal to what happens at the national level. I think we're going to see that again with this seat, whether it's Burr's seat or whether it's McCrory's seat or whether it's somebody else's seat. The Senate seat in North Carolina will get a tremendous amount of attention and be pivotal. You know, as you say, I mean, not only to the control of the U.S. Senate, but really the control and the soul of the Republican Party, not just here in North Carolina, but in the country.
It pains me. I've been friends with Senator Burr for a long, long time, and I don't want to lose a friend over this, but or lose friends over it. But I, you know, I just think that Richard needs to do the right thing now and step down. And you know, think of the party. A lot of us have supported him through thick and thin, and he's done damage to the party now. And you know, this lame excuse that he gave in the newspaper, that somehow a new precedent had been set by the Senate when they voted that the vote was that the trial was constitutional. That didn't make it constitutional. I mean, so what are you telling me, Senator Burr, that Chuck Schumer now gets to decide what's constitutional and not? I mean, the Constitution is what it is, and the only people who can change it are us, the people, we the people. And I don't know. I'm mad about it. I'm frustrated about it. I want to see him step down. I want the party to come together. I think that if we don't come together in this party, that we're never going to win another national election. And it's time for some of us to speak out, even you know, against our friends that are hurting us. And that's what I'm doing this morning. It's painful.
Yep. You know, it is. And you know, Henry, think about it this way. You know, you mentioned that you had known Senator Burr for a long time. He's, as you know, he started out in Congress and then moved to the Senate. He has well over two decades, close to three decades of public service. And over that time, he has done some really good things. He's done some good things for our state. He's done good things for the country. But, you know, his legacy will be this one vote. And I think that makes me sad, too, is that, you know, we have a public servant who has done a lot of good things. And because of again, one vote on, you know, on a rainy Saturday afternoon in February, this will forever color what his legacy is.
Yeah. And, you know, it's just, I don't know, the whole insider trading thing. He got exonerated. They dropped the charges on that and in this. I don't know. I just want him to step down. I don't want to talk about it anymore. I want him to step down. I want us to move forward and not look back. All right, let's get on to what's happening in the legislature. What's the big story this week in the legislature, Becky? Is it continue to be the schools reopening bill?
Yeah, I think that clearly is. You know, as Henry, since we talked last week, the Senate had approved that bill. It went over to the House. It got some changes that clarified some of the reopening requirements with the COVID pandemic stuff, and went back over to pass the House with five Democrat votes voting with the Republicans, went back over to the Senate. The Senate did not concur with those changes, so it is now in a conference committee. I understand that the conference committee has been meeting over the weekend. There is some immediacy, and the General Assembly feels, and particularly the leadership in the General Assembly, feels a real push to get this done. You know, every day that the kids are not in school is a day that they're falling that much further behind. So we could see that bill come out of the conference committee as early as today, as early as this afternoon, for a vote in the House and Senate.
Five Democrats in the House voted for it. That makes it veto-proof in the House. Doesn't mean... Now, we've seen this movie before. Sometimes the Democrats will vote for a bill when the governor vetoes it. They won't vote to override. But, you know,
exactly.
we're not an election year this year. But they need a few more votes in the Senate, do they not, to make it veto-proof?
Well, no, they don't. They had to. They need two Democrats to vote with the Republicans in the Senate, and that's what they had.
Okay.
Senator Ben Clark and Senator Kirk DeVere voted with the, But let me say it this way: they voted for the kids. And so, if those votes stick and they continue to vote for the kids, that would override the governor's veto. Now, here's where it gets a little bit tricky. So it goes over to the governor. He has 10 days to act. If he vetoes it, then it comes back over, and it would start in the Senate because it's a Senate bill. It goes back to the body where the bill started.
Mm-hmm.
And so that test vote would be in the Senate, and if those two Democrats, again, Senator Ben Clark and Senator Kirk DeVere, if they sustained their vote for the kids, then it would pass in the Senate, then have to go to the House. There's five Democrats who voted for the kids, along with the Republicans. And in the House, they need three Democrats to vote if all of the Republicans are there voting. So, you know, it's going to be a little bit tricky. We're also watching that vote is that, you know, this may be sort of the test vote of will the Democrat caucus vote with their constituents, or will they continue to vote to uphold Roy Cooper's whatever he demands of that caucus, as we saw last year. So some interesting things going down there, but the bottom line is we need to get kids back in school. Enough is enough. That's what this bill is about. So we're going to be watching that very closely.
Okay.
Henry, the other thing that we saw last week is North Carolina's revenue projection, and very good news on that front, that North Carolina is in pretty good shape as far as our economy. We've got the money coming in that we ought to be able to pay our bills, pay our teachers, pay our law enforcement officers, you know, pay all of our state employees. You know, don't forget, through all of this whole pandemic, all these businesses being closed, businesses going bankrupt, no state employees have been furloughed. No state employees have been fired. People have, you know, our fiscal condition here in North Carolina, because of the decisions that have been made over the last 10 years, that we have some stability even during these very, very rough times. You know, we have been able to keep state government going. So in spite of Governor Cooper vetoing every single budget since he's been the governor, and in spite of some of the toughest economic times that we've seen, in spite of executive orders from the governor's office that have closed down so many businesses, we're doing pretty well. Now, we still have to be careful. I mean, this is not the time to go crazy and start, you know, spending money in crazy amounts for and increasing the growth of government and that kind of stuff. We've got to be careful, but we're in pretty good shape moving forward.
Well, you have to remember two things too when it comes to those revenue projections being better than we thought. Number one, the unintended consequences of the governor's veto has been that we didn't spend any extra money since 2018. And so teachers haven't gotten a raise. Government employees haven't gotten a raise. And, of course, you know, that's the fault of the North Carolina Association of Educators with regard to the teachers. They'll blame Republicans. But Republicans had a 4% raise on the table. The governor said, no, we need 9. And so they got nothing. And and I don't know when the NCAE and the governor's going to get the message that, you know, these guys in the legislature aren't playing when it comes to that. They're going to control the raises, and there can be some negotiations. But, you know, these outrageous 9% requests are not going to work. The second thing, of course, that's helped us get through this is the fact that the federal government just keeps pumping unbelievable amounts of money into state and local governments. And, you know, you look at that and say, well, thank goodness, but don't think that's free money. We're going to pay for that, too. We're just not going to pay for it in state taxes. We're going to pay for it in federal income tax.
Yeah, and don't hope that, you know, it will continue that way. I mean, this COVID relief money is supposed to be used exactly for that, and it's to address the immediate needs caused by the pandemic. It is not designed, nor should it be, to start new government programs, to expand government programs forever and ever and ever. You know, you see this stuff coming out of the Biden administration of, you know, mandating a $15 minimum wage, you know, other pay increases and growth of government programs. That COVID money is, you know, in the budget lingo, we call that non-recurring funds that are to be used for non-recurring needs. So that money needs to be used for the vaccine rollout that, you know, once this is over, we're not going to need money for a vaccine rollout. We will have taken care of that.
The thing that I don't,
you know, some of this learning loss with the kids.
I know the $15 minimum wage has come up already in Raleigh, as well as, you know, we keep hearing about it coming out of the Biden administration. You know, the thing I don't really understand about this is why liberals can't understand what's really going to happen. You can raise the minimum wage to $15 if you want, which would double the payroll of a lot of businesses. Businesses are just going to find a way to do with less people. It's going to create more unemployment than anything we've ever seen in history. I mean,
it'll affect those at the lower rung of things, you know, those entry level and, you know, jobs for, you know, for teenagers, for college kids, you know, that we want them to begin to work, to get a sense of, you know, develop a work ethic.
Businesses can't do what federal government does. We can't just increase spending without increasing revenue, and raising minimum wage doesn't do anything to raise our revenues. And so, you know, if what it does is it just decreases the margins, and it's going to put some businesses even out of business. I think about two or three businesses I've talked to here in Eastern North Carolina that are really, really worried about this $15 minimum wage. They're going to have, but you know what they're saying? They're not talking about how they're going to have to accommodate more spending. They're just talking about how many people they're going to have to lay off. I mean, that's what the liberals don't get about this minimum wage debate.
No, you're exactly right. And the other thing is, why would you put additional burdens and handicaps on businesses, particularly small businesses, right now as they are fighting, literally fighting for their survival after this year of shutdowns and restrictions on their businesses? And particularly, you know, you look at some of those industries, the restaurants, the bars, the, you know, small dance studios and skating rinks and you know, those kind of places. Why in the world would you put additional burdens on these businesses? You know, let's get people back to work. Let's get the businesses open. Let's get the economy going again. Then maybe we can have that conversation. But
Amen.
For heaven's sake, not now.
Amen, sister. Thank you, Becky. We got to go. We're on a hard break. Talk to you soon. Keep us posted in what's happening up there in the General Assembly this week.
You know we will. Thanks,
all right,
Henry.
Thank
Have
you,
a great
Becky.
Week.
Always a pleasure. Love having you on Monday mornings. All right, quick break. We're coming back. We got our sports update, Pirate Report, and then our replay of really great laugh track this morning. If you missed it in the first hour, the late, great Red Fox, one of his great stand-ups. We'll be right back with Red Fox. Stay with us.
Why settle for less when you can get more at Greenville Toyota? Get more for your trade. Right now, we're giving you 125% over book value. Plus, you always get more with our Greenville Advantage. Get more at Greenville Toyota today.
Acre Station Meat Farm, along with Lane Angus Beef, bring you Farm to Fork Beef.
Stock your freezers now with affordable beef boxes just in time for the grilling season.
Farm to Fork Beef brings quality local beef to your family. From your traditional butcher shop, Acre Station Meat Farm. Come on down to Acre Station Meat Farm and find out why we're number one in fresh cuts and friendly service.
Acre Station Meat Farm, Highway 32 North, Pinetown.
Pepsi Wild Cherry.
Break the chain. Eat local. Tiebreakers.
Top Dog Academy provides training services and daycare for dog owners in and around Greenville. The Top Dog facility, located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bellsport, is a comfortable, healthy environment where dog owners can feel secure about leaving their pets. Top Dog Academy teaches people how to have a better relationship with their dog. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
Get ready to get more at Greenville Toyota. Get more savings on over 125 Toyotas. More savings on Corollas, $15,990. More savings on Camrys, $189. At Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
Wild Cherry.
Okay, we got that Red Fox last night. We're going to save time for that, but McGee and I were just talking about the $15 minimum wage. I was telling him I was in a, I won't say where, I was in a grocery store last night buying some groceries, and they only had two cashiers at a busy time on Sunday night, probably about 5 o'clock last night. I had to wait forever, and I was thinking, man, you know, they've cut back on employees already.
Yeah, so. I was in one over the weekend, just getting a few necessary items, and everything was self-checkout. It had gone from
having everything?
Everything, from having probably 8 cashiers to being completely self-checkout.
That's what's going to happen. We're going to have longer lines, and they're going to be self-checkouts.
Yep.
And I hate the self-checkouts because I never know how to price my bananas. I always have to call over the person to get, hey, I got bananas here.
The light starts blinking, and you're embarrassed.
act, bananas on aisle 3. All right, let's do our Pirate Report and our sports update this morning. I'm excited because Friday we start ECU baseball, and we've got all the coverage this year again on 94.3 The Game. Here's McGee with our Pirate Report.
ECU opens the season against Rhode Island in game one of a 3-game series on Friday. You can follow all the action of ECU baseball the entire season on our sister station, 94.3 The Game. The Pirates expected to return to basketball, or scheduled to return, men's basketball it is, on Sunday at Wichita State. They haven't played since February the 8th. And on the track, Michael McDowell won the Daytona 500 for the first time in his Cup Series career. McDowell was a 100-1 underdog when the race began Sunday afternoon and won for the first time in 358 Cup starts. Henry, he drove the Love's car and won on Valentine's Day. Coincidence? I don't know.
Maybe. I think not.
I don't know.
Sports update brought to you by the Air Doctor, a fully licensed air conditioning and heating repair company servicing commercial and residential customers in Greenville and surrounding areas. The Air Doctor has your prescription for comfort. All right, I am going to leave here right after the show and get my second vaccination shot this morning.
Ah.
So I'm wondering if we need to make provisions for me not being here tomorrow, because, you know, like 30%, I'm told like 30% have a really bad reaction to the second shot. And I had a little reaction to the first one.
I've heard.
So I'm wondering, do we need to make arrangements, Michael? You might want to get some best of clips together for tomorrow morning.
No, we can. I can handle it.
You and maybe we'll have PJ come in.
Yeah,
but I mean, be prepared.
I've heard, seriously, I've heard some adverse reactions to it.
You know, I was thinking that, you know, my mom, who's 93, she had no reaction. I talked to a really good friend of mine in Raleigh yesterday, who's 80. Who didn't have any reaction.
I've heard mild flu symptoms, but quickly.
Well, so I hear that first or second day after the shot, you could get, you know, chills and fever and stuff like that. So I'm kind of expecting that to happen to me, because I had some mild reaction to the first one. I might be in that 30%. I'm a big old wuss when it comes to getting shots. I don't mind the shot, but I just end up with the, you know, the after effects of it. All right, let's redo the laugh track this morning. The great Red Fox, if you ever love Sanford and Son. This is from his stand-up. It's a great bit. Here's Red Fox.
There was an old couple in the front room of their home, and they were rocking. They had their rocking chairs, and they'd been living there 53 years. This faith healer came on the radio. He said, "I can heal you tonight."
If you in the sound of my voice this evening, I can heal you tonight. If you want to be healed, put one hand on your radio and put one hand on what you want healed. So, the old lady reached over and put one hand on the radio and put one hand on an old tired heart and kept humming and singing. Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. The husband looked over and said, well, what the hell can I lose? He reached over and put one hand on the radio and sneaked one hand down his lap. He said, wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. His wife looked over at him. She said, Al, he said he could heal, not raise the dead.
That's good. I miss Red Fox. It's hard to find a Red Fox clip we can play, you know?
Yeah,
I bet.
All right, everybody have a great Monday. Hey, we're at Marabella's in Greenville, the new location of Marabella's on Fire Tower Road. If you haven't been to this place yet, let me tell you, you are missing out. I want to introduce my friends from Marabella's. I've got Sal, Massimo, and Pietro here. These guys are awesome. Not only do they make great food, they do a lot of things for the community, which we're going to be talking about. But Sal, let's start with you. Let's talk about the new location of Marabella's on Fire Tower Road. I'm a regular here. I love it. You guys call it Old World Pizza. Tell us what's different about your pizza.
Well, we got two kinds of pizzas. We have the traditional, you know, American style, and then we have the Old World Pizza, which is made with fresh mozzarella, and you know the way they do it in Italy.
Massimo, when you talk about doing this food right, it's authentic. And when I talk about authentic, you grew up in Italy, so you grew up with this food. You know how to make it.
Yeah. Because we grew up in Italy, we know the ingredient, and everything we do from scratch. And the right ingredient, it's been hard for us to bring over here. Now finally we can get the right ingredient to make a right pizza.
All right, now I'm gonna talk to my friend Pietro here at Marabella's. He's got the Nino's shirt on today. We're gonna talk about Nino's, which is another great dining experience, upscale dining experience, on another segment upcoming. But Pietro, let's talk about Marabella's. For people who've never been to Marabella's, what's the experience going to be like when they come here? Not only pizzas, but pastas, salads, sandwiches, you got it all.
Yes, we do. We have new sandwiches that we put in this new location, and we're going to spread it to the other locations.
The guys here at Marabella's have won national pizza competitions, so you know it's good. Thanks to Sal, Massimo, and Pietro. Folks, do yourself a favor. Come to the new Marabella's here on Fire Tower Road in Greenville, or Marabella's on Greenville Boulevard, or Marabella's in Washington on Carolina Avenue. Also, don't forget upscale dining at Nino's on Red Banks Road.
Living easy is the sound of children laughing as you make memories with neighbors and friends. It's the sound of nothing at all. It's the smell of the salt air. Hear the waters against the marsh grass. See the beauty of our coast. Bow Coast, located in Beaufort, North Carolina. Southern Living's best small town.